I don't think anyone plans on having anxiety. And all of a sudden it hits you. And you're in it. And you have nowhere to go but through it or out. And I chose through it.
Where are you, Shane?
Right here.
Where are we going today?
When you realized that because of floating, like, you were gonna be okay, what was that feeling like?
it sounds stupid, but it was like a simple little machine that saved my life at the time.
This environment doesn't require any drugs. It doesn't require you having to divulge personal secrets to a total stranger. It just involves you and water. As simple gets.
The tank, the pod, whatever you're floating in, it shows you where you need to heal, whether it's physical, mental, or emotional.
Floating is nothing. If you do it right, floating is the absence of all input.
I floated originally to really reduce panic and anxiety, and now I float to maintain peace of mind and to keep spreading what floating is to as many people as I possibly can, because I feel like it's my responsibility.
Why this isn't accessible and available yet to the wider medical population, I'm not sure. Given the context that a lot of our medications out there are not a magic bullet, and on top of that, are causing things to get worse, causing side effects. Every SSRI has a black label on it that says, if you come off this too quickly, you may want to kill yourself. There's a suicide warning on an antidepressant. Think of how strange that is. When it comes to your health care, you can't just take a pill and assume that all is going to be well. You have to engage in the therapy. You have to engage in the treatment. In the case of floating, the engagement is pretty minimal. You lay there and let the environment take care of you.
My body relearned how to be at peace, to be tranquil, to be safe, to be fine.
Floating is actually pretty simple. Imagine you're suspended in skin temperature water with no light or sound. In the shallow pool of water, there is roughly 1,000 pounds of Epsom salt. The salt makes the water super dense, which increases buoyancy, a lot like the Dead Sea. So anyone, and I mean anyone, floats like a cork. So why is this special? Think of the ability to shut off the outer world like a Zen monk, without the years of training. In this state, the human body can do remarkable things, both mental and physical. A lot of people know floating as sensory deprivation, but it's actually kind of the opposite. When you reduce the input from the outside, your inner senses come alive, and you can really tune into what your body needs. Scientists call this interoception. Turns out this little tank filled with water is pretty powerful.
Floating helped me beat anxiety, and I'm not the only one that floating has helped. I'm going to tell you my story, and then we're going to see lots of people using floating to better their lives, as well as the science behind why it works. My story starts here.
The first time, what do you say, Shane?
Boo.
Boo, yeah, it's December. What day is it? 4th. This is the end of 1991 and the beginning of 92. Yay! What do you say, Shane?
Cool.
Cool, man. You want to say goodbye?
Bye.
Shane's childhood, it was Like, it was happy, but it was hard because I was going through a lot. I was really sick and I'd been in the hospital, and so that was kind of a hard time for us.
Knock, knock. Who's there?
I see you.
By the time he was 3, we had moved like 4 times. By the time he was 8, we'd moved 7 times. And it's hard as a parent, because when you're in your 20s and you're having kids, you don't realize the impact.
I remember the fun times. I remember the skating and the biking and going to little like house gatherings, and it was, childhood seems so good.
He's cool, huh?
But what's interesting is like it's, if I think back, it was mixed in with a lot of really strong emotions. When I was in 3rd grade, I don't remember consciously what I was even thinking, but I remember missing my mom so badly. I carried a picture of her in my pocket, which it's a little embarrassing now, but.
He would take my picture to school and he would just sit and cry. And his teacher would call me and she'd say like, I don't know what to do. He wants to go home. I can't console him.
I would just cry. And I remember kids looking at me and I was super embarrassed. Like, I didn't understand why it was like that. And I couldn't contain it. And I remember early on people being like, what's wrong with Shane?
And that was his first episode of going through anxiety. So that's really hard to hear as a mom, because my 8-year-old had anxiety. And I feel like part of it was because I was going through so many changes. And although he had the support of me and his sister and my mom and dad, kids feel everything. And like Shane goes along and he's happy and he smiles and he goes along and he balances everybody, but he was hurting.
Yeah, it's the place. We're 3rd floor. Must have been that middle one right there, the DirecTV. And it was a studio loft. And we made a duct tape vent to cool the upstairs and then put our own drywall in there to separate it and called it a 2-bedroom. LA was crazy. So I went out to the Los Angeles Recording School.
I remember he drove off in his car and had it all packed up, and it was really exciting. It was sad for me because my first leaving and going away, but I was so excited. And he was going to go live his dream, and California just sounds so romantic, and like he was going to, you know, hit the big time.
I remember getting out to Hollywood and feeling like all the opportunity was here and it was where I was going to make it. I was like hell-bent on making it, and Hollywood ended up being the place that crushed me. It's so weird. Right off the bat, I landed a really cool internship with Resnick, the lead singer of the Goo Goo Dolls. And I was working in a studio and I was like, oh my God, I've already kind of made it. Like I have a foot in the door for something big. And then things started to kind of slip. The studio flooded and he moved the studio to his home. And I remember being like, sweet, I'll come to your home and help out. He's like, I don't need you anymore. And I was like, oh shit. And things got hard.
He kind of was losing his spark. He was losing his enthusiasm. He didn't seem really happy to talk to me. He just seemed kind of flat. And that worried me because I saw him kind of losing his personality. So I flew out and I could see Shane was not the Shane that left. We went, we stayed in a hotel so we could get away for the weekend. And it's like the middle of the night and all of a sudden Shane starts screaming, yelling like, get out, get out. And his eyes are open. So I'm thinking, he's awake. And I'm like, Shane. And then all of a sudden he stops, he lays down, he goes back to sleep.
I had a reoccurring dream of being in the middle of the ocean. It was pitch black. You could see the moonlight on the ocean and then shark fins would come up and circle. And I knew I was going to get eaten, and I was just waiting to get taken by a shark.
Oh my gosh, I was so afraid to leave him. And I remember leaving him at his apartment. And
just wanting to grab him and say, come home.
I went from that job with Resnick, and someone at that studio said, hey, we're doing movies on Sunset, and I became their production coordinator.
Roll camera, action.
We had a trade show in Vegas, and I spent a couple weeks nonstop working on this big display. We drove late that night to get into Vegas, pulled an all-nighter, set up the next day. I was feeling shaky, feeling weird, feeling like something was wrong. And we were out at dinner, and someone's like, you okay, everything? You don't look right, you seem weird. And I remember feeling like I couldn't breathe, and I was shaky, and it was something was wrong. And my body started ramping up. My heartbeat raced, I could hear my heartbeat in my ears, and it was like getting crazy, and I was starting to shake, and I was like, what if this is it? What if I fold in a hotel room? Is there anything I can do to calm myself down? I decided warm water would probably calm me down. I fired up a bath. I remember dunking my ears underwater, and I could hear my heartbeat racing, and I just was able to relax enough, maybe with the water and the warmth, and I could hear my heartbeat slow, and I recovered enough. I remember being like, that was scary. Like, what was that? Like, I almost crashed. Went to bed, and I was like, hope that's gone. And I woke up, I don't know, 4 a.m. or something. And I was like, is it gone? Is everything okay? And then my body's like, no, it's not okay. You're freaking out. What's wrong with you? Do you remember what happened last night? And it was just like ramp, 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 ramp. And then boom, I was back in it. I didn't know it at the time, but I had just had my first panic attack.
His voice starts shaking, and he just went into a meltdown.
What's wrong with me? I think it's over. It felt like I was going to die.
Everything comes out, his anxiety, his fear.
I remember just kind of like turning it over to the universe of like, have your way, because I might as well be dead. That was when the healing started. The healing started when I got all the way to the end and said, I might as well be dead. Moved back to Salt Lake, got a new counselor who I really liked. And then I remember one day him being like, you wanna know what's really powerful for anxiety? He said, meditation. And I was like, oh, I'm not into that kind of like hippie stuff. So yeah, just try a guided meditation. They'll tell you exactly what to do. You just download it, it's an audio. The guided meditations worked like a charm. Meditating was just as powerful as Xanax for me. Like it would just bring my levels down. But I remember having trouble meditating with the distractions. And I remember very specifically being like, there's got to be an easier way to meditate without like all these distractions. And I was looking for like meditation machine or meditation something. And float tanks popped up. And I remember being like, what is a float tank? The person who was all over floating, and it was this weird little niche thing, was like Joe Rogan. And there was videos of him talking about these float tanks. They were like meditation environments. The water was the same temperature as your skin, so you didn't feel the water. You didn't hear, your ears are underwater, you can't see. There's no distraction. And I watched this video by Joe Rogan explaining what the journey is like. You go in, it's just yourself, you sort through your thoughts.
It's like layers of an onion. And when you first start doing the isolation tank, you can only get a couple layers of the onion in, a couple skins loose. You can't really go to the core. It's too hard. It's too hard to completely let go who you are. But as you get better at it, and as you get more and more comfortable with the experience, you get better at actually letting go, really letting go. Letting go from letting go, letting go from the feeling of letting go from that point. Okay, I've let go. No, you haven't. Let go more.
Holy shit, like this is for me for sure. And it was fringy and edgy. Like no one was floating. In fact, there was maybe 30 centers in the whole country. The closest one to me was Vegas, which was 5 hours away. And I was obsessed with floating. I'd never even floated, and I was obsessed with it. I'm like, this is perfect. This is what I need. This is like the ultimate. I could do the deepest, best work. I was going to spend the money to go to Vegas. I couldn't buy a tank for less than like 10 grand. I would do whatever it took to float. And I remember being like, I can build this thing. Explaining what I was doing was like absolute insanity.
what the hell is he doing now?
It was like, what are you building? And I was like, it's a sensory deprivation tank.
He'd be like, well, you get in salt water and you float and you meditate.
So the water is the temperature of your skin. You don't see, hear, feel, it's just your brain.
That is creepy. Like, why would I want to do that?
Screw it, I just start building it.
Getting ready to install them, so I'm putting on just temporary braces to hold the lid right where I want it, make sure all my measurements are equal, and then I'm gonna put on the gas shocks. This is a video showing how I did the seals on all the edges. So this is garage seal, pinned to the three sides, and install it as if the outside is this way, because you don't want water going this way.
I remember getting ready for my first float.
Here we go, flipping it on, first time. Sounds good. Looks good.
The water was right. Everything was right. The room was right. I had a space heater. It was perfect. And I got in for my first float, closed the lid, and I started getting nervous that, is there enough oxygen in here? Like, my anxiety kicked right back in. I was like, I don't know if there's enough oxygen. I don't know if I can breathe. What if I die in a float tank? Like, what if this is how I kill myself? Like, what if this is how it ends? And didn't really settle into my first float. I got an oxygen meter from my finger, tested oxygen for a whole float. Oxygen was fine. Second float, pretty good. Settling in. Third float, I trusted the thing. And all of a sudden, it was like, I could settle in, I could relax. Everything was perfect. It was quiet. It was pitch black. It was me and my brain and my body. And I could feel my breathing, I could hear my heartbeat. And I settled in, and it was like a guided meditation for me on steroids, like pure peace and tranquility, no sensory input. You can settle in and you can just be. And there's nothing. And you're safe. And you can feel your body, and it feels great. And you just lay there, and your thinking's clear. Your thinking's not obstructed or distracted. I had ways I could meditate back then. I would count backwards with my breaths. Every breath I go, 100, 99. And I would watch the breath go in, watch it go out. And I could get to states that were just so peaceful. Imagine going from no tranquility, nothing's safe and nothing is right, to like, oh my God, I feel relaxed, I feel content, I feel safe. I started to be able to take the psychotic feelings I had and balance them with these shots of tranquility. And the more I'd float, the more the tranquility would just be a part of my life. And then all of a sudden, I'd go back into the panic state and I could go, but I know what it's like to feel this way. I know what it's like to feel totally fine. And I called it like kind of the state of floating. And I started bringing that with me through my day and through my life. I was floating every single morning, and my day would start off with peace and tranquility. And I would ramp up in my day, and I'd be like, but you could just be floating. Like, you could be fine. Stott, S-T-O-T-T. Shane and Sean.
Shane and Sean.
I'm Shane.
You're Shane. I didn't even scroll down. There's Shane.
What's up, man?
Hey, man. How's it going?
Ooh, sorry.
How's everything going?
Good. How are you?
Good.
So we're out here, Portland, Oregon, the home of the Float Conference, at least the last 4 or 5 years I've been here. It's really cool because it's a community and most people know each other, and we all have the same goal, which is to get more people floating, which a lot of industries I've been in, the big thing is competition and you're working against each other, but for some reason, the float industry, everyone is working with each other.
Hello.
It's good to see you.
So you're in here?
Just barely.
We just walked in.
Great to be back, you guys. You know, I was looking down at my badge and it had 5 stars on it. I said, boy, that's a lot of stars. And then I realized I'd been here for 5 years now. And this entire 5 years, I've been sort of barking about the same thing. What have I been telling you guys about? Anxiety, right? Floating and anxiety. And it's a real special treat to be able to come here and present to you, as my first audience actually, our first set of data with floating and people who suffer from clinical anxiety. This is an intervention which seems to affect both the body and the mind. And it's not just altering the way that people feel, but it's actually fundamentally altering the biology. Floating is enhancing mental wellness.
One of the things about mental disorders is people think they are alone a lot, and no one shares what's going on in their brain. I found one of the steps to healing is sharing where my head's at, sharing the anxiety, sharing the depression, sharing it all. And I'm telling you, the second I bring it up, people are like, oh my God, me too. What are you doing for it? What are you reading? Who are you talking to? And it's like I open the floodgate on people allowing themselves to tell me about it. I mean, you don't need to have any sort of spotlight to help people. Share where you're at and you'll be surprised at what people share with you if you have the guts to do it.
He's an old baby, huh? He's an old doggy, huh? Good doggy.
Hey, so much laundry. So, floating has obviously had like huge impact on my life. And this gut feeling I always have is like, how can I spread this more? How can more people know the power of floating? So I thought about a lot. What I want to do is go across the country and find people who could potentially use floating, who have never floated, and partner with centers and get them into float tanks. Get them in there, I think, twice a week for 3 months and just capture their journey. I think that's the real goal, is to just capture it. And if you're going floating for the first time, you're going to find yourself at a float center. And the reason these centers get opened up are usually pretty cool. Like the owners themselves have really neat stories because they're all about healing and it's not usually about the money. So I'm just excited to get on the road and go talk to these people. I think it's gonna be very cool.
You miss me, Wheezy? He's like, probably not. You'll still have Amelia.
Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you. You ready to chat?
Yes.
So what do you know about floating as of right now?
Pretty much that it's like a giant bathtub that's full of salt water, I want to say, I was told. And just anyone can float in it and try and relax, not think about your problems.
It's pretty good, actually. I like to get a perspective where you're at. So right now, current stress level, if you had to rate it 0 through 10, where are you at?
With the way work has been this week and learning about finals, I'd say like an 8.
Whoa, that's pretty stressed.
Yeah.
What about like the last 5 years?
If you had just an average on it. I don't know, maybe overall a 6 or 7.
That's a lot. How old are you?
22.
22, okay. What kind of a sleeper are you?
Not very good. Like the past year, I want to say past year I've probably gotten a few hours every night.
Three hours?
A couple hours, 2 to 3, possibly 4 max, just because I wake up so often.
If you could get one thing, what would it be?
Learning how to relax for a change.
My name is Caitlin, and I am floating for my PTSD, just because I dealt with a traumatic experience at a very young age. The trauma just stays put in my head.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Eric.
I'm Caitlin.
Hi, I'm Bobby.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Floating was a positive outlook for me to try and, get positive thoughts going.
So we can go ahead and get started.
I have a short form for you to look over and fill out.
You can sign anywhere with your finger there, then hit done in the corner. And it's just the top one there.
All right.
I'll get out of your way.
There you go.
Okay, you can come on in.
Oh, wow, this is cool.
You can put your things down right here on the chair if you like. You can go right over here and I'll explain everything to you. So what I'll do first is I'll explain to you how the pod works. And then I'll explain to you where everything is in the room. If you have any questions at any time, please feel free to ask.
I'm pretty ready for this, you know. I'm relaxed, but at the same time, like, I have my stresses that I carried from outside, from my day, so just gonna try and let go of all that and think positive. So I'm excited.
It wasn't something that was on our radar. Floating found us. We were just, me and my wife were just working kind of a normal 9-to-5 type job. I was fascinated by the concept of what floating entailed. It's the most honest place that you can be with yourself. There's no phone, there's no distractions. I guess removal of all stimuli, that just, there's nothing like that. And after I tried it, I fell in love with it and I knew it could help people.
You made it.
I made it.
How'd it go?
I felt like super relaxed, I'm not gonna lie.
And melted?
Yeah.
I feel like there's no typical first float. What was yours like?
Well, coming out of it, definitely felt extremely relaxed. I don't think I felt this relaxed in a long time. I really didn't expect to get too much out of it the first time, but any negative thoughts I had that I even tried to think about, it's like it wasn't there. Stress and anxiety is like the worst thing with PTSD, at least in my case, it is. But I feel like I stress a lot over things that I typically shouldn't. And I wanna say, you know, coming to this float tank pretty often would help with that, because I honestly feel just so relaxed right now. All my muscles, you know, my mind, I don't have anything bad going through my mind. So it's a great feeling.
The average float session lasts 60 minutes, but you have to factor in that you're going to do a pre-float rinse off and then a shower after. So you can be in the float suite for about an hour and 15 minutes, and then we have an area where you can put yourself back together after your float. You can dry your hair, put on makeup, put contacts back in.
You shouldn't see anything, hear anything, really feel anything. The ideal is to have no lights, have no sound, and let your mind kind of be void of all input. But maybe that's not for you for your first time. So you can control whether or not you have lights or sound.
Could you tell me about your first float experience, kind of how that went?
Yeah, that was amazing. It was almost like transcendent. I got in and
So we got into Florida last night, down here at Solar Float, and about to meet the owners. Hi.
Hey, welcome. Hi. Shane. Thank Shane. You for being here.
Hi, nice to see you. I love the warm weather. Hey. This is beautiful.
It's every day like that.
Really?
Yeah. I discovered floating back in the UK. At the time, I used to run marathon, and after running for 4 hours, it was quite hard on the muscle, on the joints, and didn't want to do the ice bath. So I wanted something different, and I discovered that you could float, and it was a miracle for me, because after my 4 hours marathon, I could barely walk, and floating a few hours, a few days later, I could back to my 7 miles training daily. And it was, for me, it was amazing because I could recover much faster and also prevent injuries.
So we have an intro package and it's 3 floats in total. We believe that that's a good number. It just gets you on that path. And the reason for that is the first float is, I don't know if I'm doing this right. I'm not quite sure what to do. I always say to our first time floaters, just play around in there. Just relax and enjoy the sensation of being in zero gravity. And then your second and your third float, you really start to get serious with it. You really start to understand what you're trying to do.
It's pretty well known that patients with anorexia nervosa have high comorbidity or co-occurrence of anxiety disorders. These are pretty anxious people growing up, even before the onset of an eating disorder. Available treatments for anxiety don't work very well. Most people who might respond to a benzodiazepine or an SSRI for anxiety in the anorexia nervosa setting, they don't tend to respond very well. What got me interested about floating in anorexia nervosa was the idea that we might have a tool in floating to investigate both the response to anxiety reduction with floating and also to look at body image in floating. One of the interesting things about floating is that there is no external or exteroceptive input coming in during the float. Visual information and auditory information is attenuated.
I noticed pretty quickly that the float environment for me felt extremely relieving. So I would float every day or every other day. It would give me something to look forward to while I was at my particularly stressful job. You know, I would know that, like, no matter how I'm feeling right now in my body, in my mind, at least by, you know, 6 p.m., after work, I'm gonna be feeling different.
So one of the things that you'll notice about this is that there's a curtain.
Yes.
And I understand that this was your suggestion. And I really like that because from a neuroscience perspective, it means that when somebody comes out of the float, there really isn't any additional information, any additional visual signals getting into the brain. Totally. And it really allows us to measure what's happening with the float. Floating is really interesting in anorexia nervosa because these patients have a high degree of concern about their bodies. Anorexia nervosa is considered to be one of the deadliest psychiatric disorders, and there are very few treatments that are effective for it. So medications don't seem to work particularly well. Therapies don't seem to work particularly well, certainly not as well as we would like.
So when I first got in the float tank, I know did what I always do when I need to feel safety, which is, you know, the body checking. I was like, okay, well, at least let me just make sure that this is all okay. Put my protruding hips, like, it just felt different. You know, my hands just slid right off. I tried to feel the my out shape of my ribs, but that didn't even feel the same because I was so buoyant in the water. And so I wasn't able to check my body in the same way that I would outside of the float tank. And so I kind of didn't have that coping mechanism, which was super scary, but ultimately I think what was the catalyst for my recovery, because I was forced to experience consciousness without my physical body. The state of feeling that pain and that obsession, it's not who I am anymore. And I haven't had an eating disorder thought in years. Eating disorders, if you have one, aren't your forever. It doesn't have to be. And they're amazing tools, you know, like float tanks that can help with that.
Well, good morning. You get to tell us. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you, buddy?
Yeah.
Oh, cute. I can see you.
Oh, man. Boys seem good. It's like so hard to be away from them right now. For me, being a dad is like the most important job I could possibly do, because I realize that like how you raise a child ripples out through their entire adult life. And so my number one and only goal is to raise my kids the best I possibly can so that they won't have to go through the challenges I went through and they can go through their own challenges. Hi.
Hey.
What's up, buddy? How are you, man?
Hey.
My name's Pat and I own two float spas, one here in the Columbus area in a place called Easton and another one in Powell, which is just north of here. And it was one of the best experiences of my life. I rocked it. That was my first like deep sleep that I had experienced in years. I kind of screwed up. I went in August of 2001 and the towers got hit in September of 2001. So it was going from I want to wear the cool uniform and attend college and stuff to, oh dear, like now it's serious. So I did a lot of deployments and I'm a combat veteran, so I've seen a lot of combat in my experience. And I had a lot of trouble just like getting to sleep and what they call like hypervigilance. But floating has helped me avoid having to do the recommended, you know, Xanax and the other prescriptions that the VA wanted to put me on, you know?
Tell me about your Veterans Day here at the center.
The 11th of every month, we let veterans come in here and float for free. The macho stuff happens before the float, and then they go back and they float and they come back out and they're like these little soft little babies that, you know, they get their butt kicked by 1,000 pounds of Epsom salt, and then they come out and they're like completely different dudes, and, you know, girls too, but the macho side of things, sometimes guys are like, oh yeah, floating, you know, I can do that in a bathtub. And then they come out and they're like, holy shit, that was awesome.
These were not subtle changes. And in fact, we, you know, we asked the patients after the session was over to sort of give us a list of all the things they had tried in life to help them relax and take off some of the edge and make them feel less stressed out, less anxious. We had patients on anti-anxiety medications. Over 3/4 of our sample had tried anti-anxiety meds. We had people who were trying other types of drugs like alcohol and marijuana. We had people who were trying psychotherapy, meditation, yoga, breathing techniques, stretching techniques, a whole range of different things to help relax. And then we asked them, how did the relaxation you experienced during today's float session compare? We tried to be as unbiased as possible, we just wanted to know. 75% of our sample said that floating had provided more relaxation than anything they had tried in the past. And this is an experienced sample. They'd been suffering for years. Some of our patients had been suffering for decades. Their entire life, in fact, had been spent feeling anxiety.
She's come a long ways from where she's been, and but she was a very happy child, adventuresome, but not as much as she is now. Now she has, yeah. Now she, she's not afraid to try or do anything. So
it's one of our family vacations. Me, my brother, my dad, my mom. We always had our little camper and we went all over the place. It's some of my best memories is going camping. I loved the outdoors. There's our camper. Oh my gosh, I remember this. So this was right after my birthday. I really wanted roller skates. And my mom was so fearful that I was gonna knock my teeth out, bust up my elbows and everything. So she took me to the store. I wanna say it was Toys R Us. And she let me pick out my favorite helmet and elbow and knee pads for my roller skate so I could go outside. I was so happy. I don't know who that is, me and someone else. I was a fat baby. My brother called me golf ball eyes and walnut cheeks because I had these chubby cheeks and these giant eyes. Yeah. He's like, hey, golf ball eyes, walnut cheeks. So, that's the man that messed with me.
wasn't expecting to come across that, but...
How's it feel?
I mean, it's one of those things that's a shock when you come across the person, or I guess the picture, because it's the first I came across the picture in a while. But... I don't know, like your heart races for a second, but I'm able to let it go. Normally I'd start crying or start getting angry immediately, but I'm already like on to the next thing. And I guess that's what the floats have helped with, is having that positive side of it.
Was this before or after?
Well, it happened from age 3 to age 12, and then he actually manipulated me and threatened me until about 16. And then I just tried to avoid the problem after that. And then it got to the point I was like, I have to tell. You know, I'm getting worse. I need to get help.
When my husband and I, and of course her brother Dustin, when we all found out that she was, you know, I'm gonna say this, sexually abused as a child, the first thing you think about is, how did we not know? And we felt like failures. You know, we didn't see no signs. We weren't educated like we are now on what those signs may be.
Decided, you know, my family should know, so I waited till my brother was here and my mom and my dad and my grandmother, and just told them all at once. Next thing you know, cops at my door and they wanted to talk. But yeah, I guess it's just another memory, just not a good one. And the way I see it, I can make good ones now. And I was strong enough to get through it.
After you told your family, what was the feeling?
Relieved and still scared, because I didn't know what their next step would be. I didn't know if it was going to affect them the way it affected me, and I didn't want that.
We were totally distraught. I mean, it just killed us. I mean, a part of us left then. And it's just like somebody, you know, like somebody ripped our heart out. I mean, we cried a lot. We held her a lot. She was shaking. It was just devastating. I just wish that she would have told us a lot sooner, so that she didn't have to go through a living hell for all those years. And anybody can wish that, but it didn't matter how many talks we had with her. You know, she wondered why she was a little girl, why we wouldn't let her go spend the night at a friend's house, because we were so protective, because we didn't want anything like this to happen to her. And it did.
What's up, everybody? My name is Shane. Today I want to cover a common issue a lot of people deal with.
The original tank was kind of clunky and a little dangerous, to be honest. So I got an email from a guy named William. He had seen my stuff online and he wanted to build an affordable tank out of canvas. We prototyped for a year and then we went to Kickstarter. Hi, I'm Shane, one of the creators of the Zen Float Tent. I'm so excited about this product because up until now, floating hasn't really been accessible to most people. Having a tank in my home, I could float whenever I wanted. It really dramatically transformed my life for the better. I found myself wanting to help other people go through that, and the Zen Float Tent is the answer to that.
And remember that mysterious pyramid that we showed you going to break? Well, we are going to check in with Ross Matthews to tell us all about whatever that was. Take it away, Ross.
What is this thing that we're looking at? It's like this, a tent thing.
Yeah, this is a home float tank. It's designed for relaxation, meditation.
Midday, everybody. We saw this yesterday online. Huge. And thought it was so cool. It's a Utah company, and it's all about the floating phenomenon.
All right, I know what to do. Hi, my name is Shane Stott. My company is Zen Float, and I'm seeking $400,000 for 10% of my company. Close your eyes with me for just a second. Now imagine you're weightless, floating in a pool of water that's heated to the exact temperature of your skin, so after a while you don't feel a thing. It's pitch black, and with your ears just below the surface of the water, the only thing you hear is the soft rhythm of your heartbeat. You settle in and enter a state of total zen. Nothing calms your mind and allows you to recover from the stimulus overload of everyday life quite like floating. I am living proof that floating changes my life. I am living proof that floating changes lives, and my mission is to bring floating into the home. Who wants to join me? 6.5 maybe? I got an 8 one time. That's not bad. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. We got invited to come on this show, and originally I wasn't interested, but I've realized now that just the power of cutting a deal on the show is, it's really eyeballs. I mean, first off, you get on the show and there's, I think, 8 million live viewers. If you cut a deal with any of the, you know, any of the investors on the show, they have access to everyone and giant networks, and they're very big public figures. So it's totally loaded. Not only are we going to be in front of millions, we have access to millions and people who have access to millions of dollars, millions of people, and it's an opportunity to like explode floating. I mean, millions of people might find out about floating for their first time. I still have trouble sleeping. It's like everything I can do to just keep my head together. In fact, I've cranked up floating just to prepare for this, because normally like I'd float once a week, but I'm floating a few times a week, because I've got to do everything I can possibly do to keep my nerves down.
So what happens if it doesn't work out?
Oh man, you know, if it doesn't work out, as far as, first off, you might go all the way to the show, do your part, and never get aired. That would be really sad. Second, if we air, do you cut a deal? And we could really use a deal, because to be honest, we need help expanding floating. It seems like a real opportunity to just grow floating fast, which is, the more people that can float, the more people that heal and are happier, and the world is a better place. People are happier with floating. So I really feel this way, and I'll say it again. I'll do, at the end of the day, I'll do whatever it takes to spread floating the fastest. I don't care who's in front, how it works, where they go float. None of that matters. Just the more people floating, the better. So here's a little history. In the 1950s, neurophysiologist Dr. Lilly and his colleague Dr. Shirley wanted to study consciousness without any external stimuli. After a handful of designs and a lot of testing, they decided on a laydown tank filled with water and a little bit of salt. They were right. It was an extremely powerful environment for studying the sensory-reduced state of the brain. But it was really hard to use because it took a lot of effort to stay on top of the water. Lucky for us, Glenn Perry, a colleague of Dr. Lilly's, had the idea to add Epsom salt, a lot of Epsom salt. He took it to full saturation and made floating effortless. Then, in the 1970s, Glenn and his wife Lee opened the very first commercial float center, which was in Beverly Hills.
Lee.
Hi. How are you?
Good.
How you doing?
Good. Good to see you.
I recognize you anywhere.
Yeah. Well, we didn't know if we had the right place, and then we saw the Samadhi sign. We knew we were good. Howdy, sir.
How you doing?
Good. Good to see you.
Thank you. You too. I'm Glenn Perry, and this is Lee Perry, and we together took on the assignment to spread consciousness through floating into the world.
Well, you were ahead of me, I think, a little bit. But
I'm always a little ahead of you.
And you're a good jokester, too. So this is our work spot. We found these. The guy we were working with closed his factory, and we were able to find all these letters.
Oh, for real?
So that's how the sign got born.
That's cool.
Yeah.
I like this sign.
I do too. I like it a lot.
These are the two things you want to look at most of all.
Oh, that's our opening of the first center in the world. It was in Beverly Hills, and we look pretty funny. So you're looking through the window.
Oh, yeah, that's very nice.
We were showing, must have been showing a film that night. When we looked at this place, it was right off of Wilshire Boulevard, right? Okay. You come to the doors over here, and then we had all this room was for after the float, so we had lots of place for people to go. Oh, yeah. This is the corner opposite here. Mm-hmm. So people could just go sit there and talk to each other afterwards. Sometimes you have two people came together to float. Mm. And so they'd like to sit privately and be able to talk to each other. We had just the tank, and then there was a thing to sit on, the shower up here, and that's all that there was in there.
What kind of blows my mind is it's the first float center ever, and it's the first float tank ever. The first float tank company, float tanks.
Yeah.
And you guys were figuring it out. In Beverly Hills in what year? 79?
Yeah.
Wow. That is pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I thought that I would not be able to get to where I wanted to go to as a result of floating if I didn't float for an hour. So if I didn't have an hour, I wouldn't float. So then I got out of the habit of doing it. One day I woke up and said, I'm going to float every day no matter what, even if it's 3 minutes. And suddenly I was floating all the time and I stayed in the habit, and that was the best thing I ever did.
I don't know where you want to be, but...
Originally it was 4x8 foot box, 4 foot high, and people had to climb over the top. And then we cut a door here and a door here, but the door here, condensation would fall.
Yeah. It was a box, and I remember him thinking about that, what he looked like. Glenn's eyes do all the thinking, you know, and he's walking around and I can tell what he's thinking about. And I was there when he exploded with smiles. I got it, he said. And he got cutting that cut.
Cut that off?
Yeah. I mean, cool now you can stand up in it.
Most of us spend our life in mental chatter, thinking, worrying about the past and the future, projects and relationships. And when we float, we can move from the past and the future into the present so that we're actually here to receive whatever's going on, so we know how to be, how to act, how to function, and how to relate. In other words, floating is a time machine to the present. And that's what consciousness is, being there for what's happening.
Back in LA again, doing more television work. That's what I call it, because it feels like a lot of work for me. But on the other side, it's always like,
did it. So many more people know about floating. It was worth it. But I'm just going to read you the section of my journal and continue to work on managing my nerves. And I wish the hotel had a float tank. Here we go. Yesterday when we were standing in place, waiting to tape, I had this moment of realization. I broke in LA. I went through hell in LA. I recovered, I fought back, and I created a tool to help people help themselves. I thought of all the chaos, all the crying, all the fear, all the desperation. It feels good to know I did it. I stuck it out, saw it through, and made something positive from it. A little cheesy, but it does. It feels like all of that suffering was worth something, and I still suffer from nerves for the same purpose, but it's worth it, so. See you on the other side.
Okay, so before, this is how it was stacked. And I actually had this one on the back side to push my lower back in because a lot of this is what hurts. I was driving to work one day and I came to a sudden stop because of the whole line of people in front of me, and a truck driver, an 18-wheeler carrying pipe, obviously wasn't paying attention, and he slammed into the back of me. After really 2 years of fighting the pain and the headaches and the dark rooms and everything else, that's when they finally decided that I was gonna have to have surgery. I had a cervical fusion, and they took a bone from my hip and put it in my neck in place of the cartilage. I guess it was probably about six months later, I realized my hip wasn't healing right or there was something wrong with it. And so I went back to the doctor and said, there's something wrong with my hip. You know, it's like sitting down, it hurts. And it got worse and worse over time. You know, it just seemed like a vicious cycle. It'd be doctor after doctor after doctor, and it was always refer you here, refer you here. I'm not opposed to trying stuff. I mean, I'll go to the ends of the world to get rid of this pain. I'm anxious and excited to be able to feel weightless. I mean, when your life is all about how to sit and how to feel and everything else, it'd just be nice to not feel anything. Good girl. To me, yard work is a getaway, and when I'm out here, I don't think about anything. I don't think about hurting. I don't think about anything other than making sure that this is clear again.
All right, let's see what we can catch today. My wife and kids, they all love to fish. We'd go Friday nights, we'd go fishing at night, go night fishing for catfish. My wife, she will. That's what's so amazing about her is she's got, you can't see the pain. If you asked her that 1 through 10 thing like doctors say, she could be out fishing and it can be an 8, but you'll never know it. I'll know it, but you'll never know it. She'll mask it, she'll hide it. She'll fight through everything not to ruin a day for anybody else. And she basically just has in her mind, you know, when I get home and close the door and nobody's around, I'll take the pain at that point. You know, I'll deal with it then. Obviously, my greatest fear is that it doesn't work, because we've been through stuff. We've been through 10 years of stuff that doesn't work, and If I could take it on, you know, I would, man, I, that'd be the happiest day of my life if I could just snap my fingers and say, give it to me. But we've been through 10 years of experiments and can't find what's wrong with her and can't, nobody can fix it.
Hi, Deborah. I'm Emily. Nice to meet you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
To meet you. Thank you for having us. Thank you. Thank you very much. We appreciate you. Yes, I'm very excited about it.
So quiet.
Yeah, we're just here for you. This is a relaxation room. Whether you float separately or together, this is where you can meet up with each other.
What are some things that you shouldn't do when you do go floating?
Well, the number one is don't go in with expectation. Let the float take you where it's supposed to take you, whether it's your first time or your 100th time. I did experience a lot of pain in my first float, which is common for people with chronic pain. And that's something that we really try to walk our clients through too if they come in with that type of pain. And that was something I experienced. I was in a lot of pain the first 20 minutes of my float from all of those places that my body needed to heal and realign and work out those old injuries. But since then, I mean, I started floating regularly that day. and now I experience no chronic pain on a daily basis. I sleep better. You know, by floating, it really kind of takes out all the gunk that just gets in the way of your thought process and provides that clarity. So every single day I can wake up and I can say, this is what needs to be accomplished to help the most number of people today through floating.
What's rope? Here's yours.
Thank you for coming in.
Oh, dude. Oh, no way. Got your Aaron Rodgers?
Yeah.
You guys have floated a lot of athletes.
Oh, we have anything from like a gold medal wrestler to the coach of the crew. Captain of
the MLS coach?
Yep. Captain of the Blue Jackets to Matt Brown, who's a UFC fighter. This is Michael Thomas, who's a rookie of the year last year for the NFL.
We've been really lucky. We've been open May of 15 was our first store. So what is this? So 3.5 years, and we've developed relationships with NHL here and MLS and then Ohio State. And thinking about how much we help them is awesome.
Masters, oh, she's got that.
And
wow.
That is it. Jamie Colleen with the arm bar in the third round.
Hi, my name is Jamie Colleen and I'm a professional MMA fighter. It's mixed martial arts. So we utilize striking, kickboxing, Muay Thai, wrestling, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Judo, so essentially it's just all the martial arts tied together. I've been training under Daniel Gracie here at Hensel Gracie Philly for a little over 3 years now. I also train at my striking coach, also has a school in Kensington, Extreme Evolution Fight Camps, so we spar and train there as well a couple times a week.
this is set. Let's go.
Jamie showed up at our door, gosh, I want to say it was like 2 years ago. She had heard about floating, and she wanted to get in the tank to kind of just experience the recovery aspect, and also, you know, the benefit of that sharpening of the focus that she could really get in there.
I noticed that I just felt better after floating. I felt like my body was just relaxed and just, I just felt totally recharged and just kind of renewed after.
Is this after like a long day of training or a long day of actual fights? Or when's your body at its worst?
Training. I mean, granted, after a fight, I'm pretty beat up. But I tend to float 2 to 3 times a week. If I can stay consistent with that, I mean, you know, it's
tricky.
Yeah, it can be with our schedules. But I really try to make it a priority because over time, I realized that it was helping me so much mentally as well.
My name's Carrie McGinn, and I'm the owner of Halcyon Floats in Philadelphia. Ultimately, we believe that everyone should be in a float tank. We're trying to provide the most comfortable space for anyone who's interested in incorporating floating into their lifestyle. We believe that you can get profound relief from your everyday life, just stress relief in general. So we try to just basically reach out to the population at large. But that said, we attract a lot of athletes. You know, some we can talk about, some we can't.
What have you noticed with the athletes?
A lot of them walk through the door at the recommendation of their trainers. Ah. They do come in widely for that recovery. Yeah. And then we'll see that they'll come in for the focus benefits and just the overall rest. You know, you gotta imagine that someone who's a competitive athlete is under an enormous amount of stress. So just being able to get away from that for 90 minutes and go into the tank and get that relief, all the while being able to like really focus and hone in on how they can improve.
The Union's leading goal scorer trying to add to his tally, and he does! Goal number 9 on the season, and it's 1-0
yeah,
Philadelphia.
That's silly. Ever seen it, man? Jeez Louise.
Can you put that in the documentary? That lady needs to float.
She need a float, though. My name is CJ Sapong. I'm a professional soccer player. Ooh, I've now been floating for about 3 years. I took to it immediately. I think it helped that I was so sore and so messed up. So I was able to feel right away, okay, wow, like, I can walk and not feel my lower back pinching. Or it's like you first want to find other reasons, because naturally, as I think as humans, we want to be skeptical first, which can help too. But after 2-3 times, when you have effects that are lasting longer and longer after float, you can't deny it any longer. And I think if you can be by yourself and guide your thoughts in a way that are going to benefit you, it will definitely translate into, you know, life outside of the float tank.
Hello, Shane.
Clay, how's it going?
I'm okay. How are you doing today?
Pretty good. Just doing the usual.
Floating?
Yeah. How'd you know? Always working on something float. What's going on?
It's not the news I was hoping that we'd be giving to you. Sorry to say that your pitch won't be airing.
Oh, man. Well, thanks, Clay. You're a stand-up dude. Thanks for calling me and delivering the news yourself.
thank you, Shane.
Yeah.
And again, thank you. We really do appreciate everything and you making the trip. I'm sorry we didn't have a... we wish that every one of the people that came in got a deal and that everyone would get to air, but it just didn't happen this year.
All right. Well, thanks, Clay. If I ever can help you out or you ever need anything in the float world, just let me know.
Will do. Thanks, Shane.
Thanks.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye. That sucks so bad. I probably wrongfully assumed that, like, because he needed to call me, And that he wanted to set it up, and his assistant got a hold of me. I assumed probably gonna air. And we're out here in the Salt Flats, like an hour out of my hometown. We're getting ready to shoot the Kickstarter video to air, hopefully when Kickstarter was going to air. And this is sadly familiar with pushing floating. It's like, it's always just real close to the edge of pushing it over the edge. And then it doesn't quite get there. And it's just, this is just the way it is, man. Oh, God damn it. Well, here we go, man. This reminds me of everything I've ever been through. It's just another thing. Like, you just roll with it. You just adapt and go on. Let's go keep plugging, man. Let's go shoot the Kickstarter video and see how that goes. Just keep grinding.
My name is Andy Larson, and I own Float Milwaukee here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
I love these pools.
Yeah, they're great.
So why would someone prefer a pool over a pod?
It's really subjective. So what I tell people when they ask me is, if you're someone who is worried about claustrophobia, and I explain how the pods really aren't claustrophobic, but if you're someone who has that concern, can ease into it with the pool. So there's no lid, of course, as you can see, it's round, it's bigger. People that are like really tall or want to like stretch a lot or whatever.
How big is that?
This is about 8 feet wide or diameter.
And you can almost go like.
I can totally do the Vitruvian Man. Yeah, it's nice. Whereas in the pod, I can go, if I go like this, I'm touching both sides. In this, I can go like full, which I like. So, which is why I kind of like this a little bit better. This is also less humid. So if people really don't like a lot of humidity, I say this is a good option as well. If someone is super, super sensitive to temperature, then I'll say you might wanna stick with the pod just because it's more consistent. But that's, again, it's very variable depending on the person, so. My main goal is just to help people, really. I mean, at its base level. There's a lot of stress in the world. There's a lot of things that people are dealing with. And based on what I've read, based on seeing people in here, based on videos, based on my own experience, I know what floating can do. And so just to be able to offer something that maybe someone hasn't heard of or thought about, that could just even complement whatever they're doing already, just to help them further along, that is why I'm here.
Cool, man. So this is your cabin?
This is our cabin.
What do you call it?
We call it the Dream Pod Cabin.
Uh-huh. Can I get in it?
You can definitely get in.
I want to see how spacious this
is. Man, this is still in middle of production. There's a bunch of work that still needs to go into it.
I can almost like, I'm 6 feet tall. Why do you put so much effort in the design?
I think the pods, or flotation in general, I think the pods need to be, one, it has to be welcoming. It has to be beautiful. It has to be sexy. You have to be wowed when you come into a float center and you pull up the door and that beautiful blue light comes in and the doors open really wide and the client that's about to float has to feel comfortable. As you know, a lot of people, or some people, feel a little nervous before most. Coming. Most people come and they feel, what, you want me to get in there, close the lights? But when it's sexy, beautiful, it's easier. It's easier. It's a welcome. It's like, come float inside of me. We've got pods all across North America, at least 8 or 9 countries in Europe, South America. Then we've got pods, obviously a very good market today for the float industry is Australia and New Zealand. I would say we have just under, we've got pods in just under 30 countries. Yeah, it's global, man.
Most biomedical research in America is funded by National Institute of Health. This is at all universities and all academic institutions. And there has never been a single NIH-funded float grant in the history of floating. So we've applied now and just reapplied, resubmitted, and I think we have a shot. That federal funding is critical for our research to sustain itself over the long term. There's no way I'm going to be able to continue this research without it.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Hey, how are you doing?
Good, good. How are you?
Hey, nice to meet you.
You too, Shane.
Nice to meet you. Shane. Yeah. Thanks for coming
Thanks for coming in.
Yeah, for sure. I'm happy to be here.
The terminology that we're using to describe our lives today are very misleading. We say connected, but we don't really know what that means anymore. You know, there's no connection in social media. You're interacting through an interface, a device. Whereas you used to call somebody up and say, hey, how are you doing? Let's get together. You know, or you would actively take time and search them out and spend time with them. So we've traded these real connections in real time for something that's an illusion. And we understand that at a subconscious level, that I'm not interacting with these people in the way that I really want to. And that causes a disconnect, because most people know what real interaction is. It happens daily in their lives when they're interacting with their loved ones around them. I know for a fact that people have that reconnection. You know, you see it on their faces, you see it in their body language and how they walk out of the rooms and they walk out the door and go about their day. And they've had a real moment with themselves for the first time in maybe years. You understand that in that quiet, in that darkness, is what you've forgotten about yourself. The power of your thoughts and understanding that being present is why we're here.
This is from the nerves.
Yeah.
They're just right on the other side.
Oh, this is so sad.
This is what I've dealt with my entire life.
Just your entire life. Jesus.
Interact.
The only people that have ever seen what my anxiety does, my wife, my parents when I was little, but, you know, as a teenager and I hid it. And so really, I think my kids have seen it a couple times, but I usually try to get out and hide somewhere. But I like to believe that my kids don't have a clue, but I know they do. I know they do, because that time when I was, a couple weeks ago, I was gonna do that commercial, my son said, I know a couple people that can do that. And I kind of griped at him later and I said, what are you thinking? I said, we can do the commercial and we can tie our business to it and stuff. And he goes, I didn't think you could do that. I didn't think you would be able to handle that. You know, and it crushed me.
With mental disorders, which I'm very, very, very familiar with, panic, anxiety, depression, there's a certain amount of being messed up that makes you feel responsible for ruining other people's times or being a drain or an anchor. And if you care about people, which most people do, it becomes like a thing where you feel like a burden or a problem for everyone in your life, and you can't fix it,
and you can't think your way out of it, and you can't think yourself happy. And worse off is when people don't understand it and they go, just quit it, or just be happy, or just quit worrying. Because truly, when you're mental, it's irrational, it doesn't make sense, and you can't fix it. It's like a sprained ankle. If someone's like, just don't have a sprained ankle, man, just like quit it, quit limping, and you can't. And you can't even rationally explain why you can't, but you feel like a drain on everyone around you, or you feel like an anchor, and it's just, it's awful. And I've been this guy to many people in my life, and it's sad, man. I feel like mental disorders are almost the worst, because like when it's physical, you can show someone, look at this cast, like look, I have a broken arm, like it's busted, right? Like you don't expect me to use this hand, like this arm, like a normal person, right? You'll cut me some slack, and I don't have to be normal. Like you can see this cast, it's busted. But with a mental disorder, like you can't, there's nothing to show anyone. You can't explain it. It's not rational. It's busted. But you have no way to prove that it's busted, and no way to explain what's going on in your head. And so I just feel like I have so much compassion for people with mental issues, because they don't have a cast to show someone. They don't have stitches. They don't have anything. They're busted with nothing to show for it. So I get it. I've been there.
Nice to meet you.
Those are Richard Waite.
Nice to meet you.
Pleasure, sir. Pleasure. Yeah. Thanks for having us out.
They told me a lot about you guys, and you've been on quite a journey this past
year. Yeah, that is for sure. That's for sure.
Definitely
been a journey. Yeah, so looking forward to the next part of it.
You know, here we have awesome. our float clinic and research center. So really come on in.
I have a specific reason, obviously, for wanting to try this. And all I can say is I hope it works, because the best way I can explain anxiety for me is, if you're scared of heights and you close your eyes, and when you open your eyes, you're standing on the edge of a cliff with your toes hanging off the cliff looking down. That's how I wake up every morning. When my eyes open, it's terror. And I don't know, I can't identify what is the terror for? I don't know. I there's not something. It's the things I don't know, and the things I don't see, and the things that could happen. So that's been my entire life. I have stopped pursuing dreams, things that I wanted to do. I was pursuing a music career in my 20s, and I felt like it was going to kill me.
The control room is actually more like mission control. How do we launch the floats, keep track of all the floats? And so the idea of this room is that, you know, the data from the closed pool, from the open pool, all comes in real time through wireless connections. And you don't even feel them when you're floating.
Nice.
And as you're floating, we'll be in here, able to see your heart rate, able to see your breathing rate, your blood pressure, your brain waves. And the idea here is we're very curious about sort of the rate at which the brain is firing and how that changes in this environment.
And this is all so fascinating, and it's interesting, and the fact that he's even here doing it's pretty amazing in itself.
So we're going to get ready to start him off on his float. All right, Richard, could you hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right, great baseline session. We got some good readings. Go ahead and take your time and get into the pool whenever you feel like you're ready. So So we'll get ready to start our float session. Water temperature hovering at 95 degrees. I lowered the room temp to about 89 degrees for him. Normally it's a little hotter, about 92 or so. So we're gonna go ahead and start the session. You're gonna see as he's getting in, the posture is gonna change to him from standing to lying.
Oh, wow.
You'll also see, we'll know that the pool's being occupied because the water level is going to change.
Okay.
So baseline heart rate getting in, we see this a lot, an anticipatory heart rate response, about 100 beats per minute. Right now his respiratory rate is dropped as well. It was between about 15 to 20 breaths a minute at baseline. Now we're hovering around 10 or 11 breaths a minute. So we're starting to see aspects of the relaxation response that is pretty typical of a float session. And his brainwave data looks great. I could tell you it took us a long time to figure out how to measure brain signals in there. Now we're able to do it reliably. It's fantastic. You could actually see on the brain signal, it's so sensitive that it's even picking up his heartbeats. You see those little?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Those are his heartbeats.
That's insane.
So, it's pretty neat to be able to monitor in real time how somebody's body and brain is changing. And that's something, once again, that 5 years ago would have been impossible. So do you want to take his 5 minute reading?
Sure.
Okay. Do the honors.
Okay.
Let's see what we're getting here. So here we are, 5 minutes in. Look at that. 117 over 72. So basically, what was his diastolic in the first one? 95?
95.
So in 5 minutes' time, he had a 23-point drop in diastolic. I mean, to me, that's incredible. You know, it's so hard to reduce blood pressure, even 5 or 10 points, but in 5 minutes, he dropped over 20. And that's, you know, really incredible. What was his systolic?
127.
So he dropped 10 points already in systolic. So a 10-point systolic, a 23-point diastolic, it's incredible. And it shows you what his tension is like every moment of the day until it finally gets a chance to relax. And that's so important because, you know, one of the biggest indicators of health, both physical and mental, is blood pressure. And this is sort of a really keen indicator that we're tapping into.
I cannot think of a time in my life where I have not been struggling with anxiety. I can't think of a time. Things that are completely fun, I am fighting anxiety of things that are the unknown, things that I can't, there's no explanation to them. I worry about worrying, you know, that's just what people with anxiety do. As long as in my whole life. And this last couple months with floating, I feel like I'm stepping forward. I feel like I'm moving forward.
I like being in the water, but you don't feel that it's water when you're in it. So it's a completely different feeling than any other therapy that would be out there.
when she come back from her first session, she was like really pumped, and she goes, wow, Mom, she says, I lay there in total darkness and felt nothing. And she says, and it felt really good. It felt good to feel nothing.
Definitely want to continue it. You know, it's been a good thing so far.
I think that it is working to help me manage pain. I can say without a doubt that it's working. I didn't look for a major change in my body after I floated once, and that's what people have to understand. And what I stress to them when they ask me about it is, it's a process. I don't think that there's a set time frame on where it stops or where it starts working. I really think that I have to keep floating, and there's going to be so much more. And I'm hopeful that maybe one of these days I'm going to call you and go, I'm off pain medication and I float every day, and that's what's worked.
Floating has been a gift for Shane. And now he's sharing his story, which is sometimes hard to hear as a mom. But you know what? He is so compassionate that now he can share that with others.
I'm highly motivated because I want to get the best out of life that I can. Before, I didn't really care.
She isn't as angry as she was before. She was very, very angry that the things that had happened to her and she had no control over. And it's nice to see her not crying all the time and seeing her smile a lot more and starting to feel better about herself. That was a big plus. Her self-esteem has gotten so much better.
If I stopped floating now and never did it again, I think at this point I have my brain and my body trained to just relax when I'm super stressed, you know, oh, time to let it go.
Wow, like a permanent adjustment.
Yeah.
There is more things that you can do than just medication and things you can do on your own. So I would think it'd be well worth trying because I have my son back.
If you really believe it's over, for me, it was over. So imagine going from it's over to it's potentially not over. And it could potentially be good again. So as far as reason to live, go from one end of there's no reason to live to like there's all the reasons in the world to live again. That's the kind of transition you can make, and the feeling is indescribable in a way, but it's crossing from one end to the other in a moment, and that's a powerful thing.
It's hitting a part of their psyche that I think a lot of other available treatments are missing, because it's making them want to live again. It's giving them a hopefulness for the future that they had been lacking prior to floating. And it's giving them the opportunity to experience their body and their minds in a state that has been missing from their life for so long. You know, we had a patient who I was interviewing after their float, and the patient came up to me and said, you know, even if that only lasts for an hour, just being able to know that I am capable of feeling that way again was worth it. And that's a fascinating thing for a patient to say, because they didn't even realize that it was possible to feel that way.
Everything in life seems to balance out. It has its ups and its downs. It's growing, it's decaying, it's dying. But life has this rhythm going on. And for me, one of the early things I gave myself as far as beliefs was, if it can get this low, it can get that high. That was like a natural law that things balance. So I said to myself, if I can weather this, it can balance. And the balance of this is going to be great. The best odds of anything I can think of is to try floating, because you don't know what it can do. And oftentimes, I found this with a lot of things, you start one good habit, because floating is not going to cure you. I will
say that flat out. Floating will not cure you. However, if you start floating and you start feeling good and you start having hope, all of a sudden you're gonna be like, maybe I should eat better. Maybe I should maybe see a counselor. Maybe I should maybe have a little more work-life balance. Maybe I should do things I enjoy more. So the catalyst that floating can be is huge, and I feel like what it's done for me is monumental, and I just want to spread that, and I want to give people that hope. Before today, LA held a place of more like fear and panic and anxiety and bad memories. And then going through all the spots and seeing it with fresh eyes and non-anxious, non-panicky eyes, healthy eyes, like wrapping it up like this, something so good came from so much pain. So it's like just a really cool thing. I'm like really happy about the future, and I'm really happy to see floating go mainstream. So it all makes sense now. So I'm pretty happy. So I just got a text from Justin Feinstein. It says, Shane, I got the NIH grant, exclamation point. It's the first grant they have ever given to floating, and we start the clinical trial in a month. I think you have to come back and film the start. This is how the movie ends. Going back to Tulsa, man. That's such a big deal.